I've been studying data centers for maybe 4 or 5 years. Obviously, they're getting a lot of attention at the moment because of the energy, but they are also very water intensive. And part of the reason why the climate of Ireland somewhat suits them is it's more temperate, so there's not fluctuations. For the water, it's pretty much all for cooling. And on average, a data center uses about 500,000 liters of water a day, but that can go up to 5 million. Obviously, these figures are difficult because data centers are different in sizes, but in the same way that we talk about an average data center's energy requirements. Something like the Shannon pipeline, which is this huge infrastructural project to bring water from the River Shannon up to the greater Dublin region. One of the things that they include in their estimates about future water needs is the needs of industry. Obviously, Intel is a big operator in the greater Dublin region, energy and water requirements. But I think data centers are the other major industry that are going to require this water. So again, issues there are around if there are water shortages, if there are another hot summer, things are going to become more extreme. The data centers need more water because they need more cooling. But so does everyone else need more water. You know, farming, agriculture needs more water. People in their houses need more water. Vulnerable people need more water. And that is where, again, you have these contradictions over whose needs are met, should be prioritized. And it's only in times of infrastructural breakdown, like when there is a water shortage or if there is an energy blackout, that I think these issues are going to really come into the kind of public consciousness in a way that might mobilize people, like what happened with the water charges. Energy or water, infrastructures are public. The infrastructure shouldn't be developed or orientated too much towards the needs of certain sectors, industry. This great fortune that we have in being a developed country in the global north, where we can take these things almost for granted, a right to water, a right to electricity. And I think that there's an understanding that the state has responsibility to look after those infrastructures as part of the public good. And when those things fail, citizens will be angry. And that anger will be directed at the current government.
What value do we place on this expansion of data centres relative to our other economic activities? I mean, what do we do? Take more cars off the road, ration petrol, have deeper cuts in agriculture, deeper cuts in milk output, beef output. You know, these are the kind of hard trade-offs we're now going to get into. We do need to build more electricity capacity because part of the strategy for decarbonizing heating and transport is to electrify as much heating and transport as we can. But if at the same time we're adding additional electricity demand that is new energy use that we don't currently have at all, then that will inevitably mean that it'll be much, much harder. Yes, absolutely, take action to ensure reliable electricity supply. But one of those actions would be to constrain or limit or even stop further data center development. That will absolutely contribute to electricity security.
It's not just the data centers. It's a political economy that revolves around foreign direct investment. If foreign direct investment is what the economic base relies on, then there are always going to be these contradictions where, you know, social and environmental burdens will be kind of allowed or justified because we need these industries, we need them to come here. But periodically, and I think it's the case with the data centers, it's causing conflict, it's causing opposition, it's bringing to the surface that there are these contradictions. And I think particularly in the context of climate change, maybe it will be something that really forces the hand of the government of the state to be like, okay, maybe we need to take a step back. I think what will happen is the data centers will be presented as a way for rural regions to get investment and jobs. But beyond construction, there are not many jobs associated with data centers. I mean, a data center is a big shed filled with servers. And those servers are managed for the most part algorithmically. That's the kind of sophistication of these infrastructures. And obviously that requires maintenance, but that maintenance isn't going to provide lots of jobs. And I'm even skeptical of the kind of figures that are put out there by the data center industry representatives, IDA. You know, the figures that they use is maybe 30 to 40 permanent jobs per data center. That's not backed up by what I understand from talking to people in the industry or, you know, people who know more about how these things operate, because it's just not clear what those jobs would be for. And the other thing about those jobs is that if it is about maintenance for the most part, you could have an engineer or an operator managing multiple data centres.
There is this myth that a constantly growing economy makes everything better. It doesn't. There's a huge amount of academic research that shows that beyond a certain level of affluence, further growth in economic activity does not make people happier. It doesn't lead to better health outcomes, it doesn't lead to better education outcomes, it doesn't lead to better happiness across society as a whole. So reprioritizing away from maximizing economic activity can be a positive thing for our societies, as opposed to being viewed as giving things up. In order to reduce energy use quickly enough on an emergency basis, we need to build a society that has cultural norms that value lifestyles that are low impact on the environment and on the planet more highly, and that value societal cohesion, equity in society, and education above economic activity just for the sheer sake of economic activity. We know that social media is addictive. It's designed to be addictive. It doesn't improve lifestyles. Inventing new addictions is not a way to improve our societies. And building out data centers just because that's economic activity and we think all economic activity is good, without allowing for the negative externalities, things like addiction. We really need to take a more balanced view of those things and think about what's really important to us as a society. We're going to have a completely transformed society in 30 years anyway. The question is, do we manage our own path in an active way? Do we set out where we want to get to, what kind of society we want to have, and build towards that in a way that minimizes our impact and minimizes our contribution to these severe planetary scale problems that we now have? Or do we stick with what we have been doing, which is to prioritize sheer economic activity above all else, and just assume that happiness will follow? Then we will be forced to change.
You know, Ireland has its commitments under the Paris Climate Agreement, under EU policies, to get 70% renewable energy on the grid by 2030 and to cut emissions. That is already a very difficult ask. It's going to require huge transformations in our energy generation, in our grid, and it's made a lot harder by the demand represented by data centers. So AirGrid's figures currently take up 11% of the grid. By 2030, it's estimated there'll be about 28% of the grid based on existing connections. Any way you cut it, these figures are all huge figures. They're huge drawdown on our grid. AirGrid have made it very clear that there might be brownouts or blackouts this winter. And so in that context, it doesn't seem like a huge ask to say that for the time being, given the critical situation we're in terms of energy security, around moving towards renewable energy generation in the grid, and also get a better sense of what data centers bring to Ireland in terms of economic development, regional development, jobs. All of those things are unclear. And on the basis of that, I think, you know, having a moratorium, it makes sense. In 2019, Singapore introduced a moratorium on data centers. So 2 years later, it's still in place. It hasn't led to the implosion of the Singaporean economy. It hasn't led to a drying up of investment. It hasn't led to a drying up of even relationships with the tech companies that want data centers. Tech companies are now being forced to work with the Singaporean government more directly to try to find solutions for problems that effectively they are causing. Taoiseach Micheál Martin gave his speech to the UN, and he used this very significant platform to talk about climate change and climate action. And he had this, you know, line which, you know, then was circulated in the media about how we globally are facing this climate abyss, which is not a weak word. And then to come back and to dismiss pretty much outright the need for a moratorium on data centers that are going to consume so much energy, provide not a lot of employment. It really emphasizes the two-faced nature of the government. And I would include in that the Greens particularly. I think it's really galling. And I think that this issue really highlights that there is this huge gap between what needs to happen and what the government are willing to do.
But in terms of actually taking effective action at this point, talking to your friends, talking to your neighbours, but contacting your local politicians, your councillors, your local government politicians, and your national politicians, your TDs, your senators, lifting the phone, sending an email, telling them you're concerned. That's the first thing. But then networking, there are various NGO groups active in climate, the Stop Climate Chaos, umbrella, and ask them, what can you do to help? It's campaigning, it's getting people on the street, if necessary, to express themselves. And politicians will listen to their constituents, but only if their constituents are vocal. That will make a difference, and is well worthwhile getting involved in those activities if you possibly can.